see you anymore. Oh, how can I keep from crying? Oh, how can I keep from crying? Oh, how can I keep from crying? For I never expect to see you anymore.
Listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Good morning and welcome to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9, or you can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. You can call us here at 614-5553. Good morning, Debbie. Tell me what's going on.
Good morning. I'm over here doing the audio repair. And
did you get it fixed?
I got it fixed when I just turned up the volume.
Oh, yeah, that'll help every time.
Yeah, that's good. How are you this morning, Ron?
I'm here.
We haven't been here much, or...
I haven't been here much lately, but we weren't here last Saturday, the first time we had missed a show in 5.5 years.
Due to weather?
Too much ice last year.
Ice, ice baby.
Last week. And then a couple weeks before that, I've been at state wrestling tournaments. So I've been here once in about the last
four or five weeks.
So I'm back.
Well, welcome back. Welcome back. We're glad to be here. Today is the last day of February. 2015, and as we were eating breakfast this morning and leaving down at the spot, who has a great breakfast, by the way, we saw people going into courthouse to pay their taxes. So if you haven't paid your taxes, I'm sure they're just going to be open a short amount of time today. Be sure you get down there and get
that. Probably lunch.
4:30.
They're going to be open to 4:30
at the courthouse.
Yeah, you need to come pay your taxes because tomorrow you'll have a late fee.
Mm-hmm. So. And I hope the line is shorter than what it was the other day when I encountered it on Wednesday. But Mike Smith came out and he passed the hat in the hallway. He said, "Everybody that's got their little bill and their check already made out could just hand it to him." And that took about 40 people out of that line in front of me.
That's the key thing. If you have your bill, have your check made out, you can just drop it off. If you don't have it, you get to stand in line.
They'll mail you a receipt.
Like Deb, who did not have it with her, had to stand
because
in line. I don't know why. You tell me why.
Because I kept telling the wrong people to change the address on it, and finally somebody told me the right person to tell. So next year we'll get one in the mail. But anyway,
all right, go ahead.
We have our some folks with us down from the Agricultural Extension Agency, I guess we call it. And they're going to be talking about the past and the present and maybe the future of the agency, and we're glad to have them with us today. We have Kim Frady and Robin Ramsey and Kathy Irwin.
And now, Kim, Irvin. Tell her the correct Irvin. Name, please.
Catherine.
Tell her the correct name.
The correct name is UT TSU Extension.
That's why I didn't say that. It's longer than my mind works these days.
We've undergone several changes, and that's probably our latest change.
And tell them what all that means there so that they people.
Well, actually, we're a part of the University of Tennessee, and we're the extension arm, I guess, is how you would categorize us as being a part of the university and part of the College of Agriculture. There's four things in the College of Agriculture. There's the teaching college, the veterinarian school, the experiment station, and extension. So we're one of the parts of the College of Agriculture at the University of Tennessee.
You know what I like to do? I like to go up to the UT Gardens and just stroll around at that beautiful gardens.
Yep. That's part of one of the things that, and our master gardeners enjoy going up there and doing that too.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a new class coming?
Yes, got a new class going right now. We're in week, we got snowed out week four, so I guess we're in week three now of this year's master gardener class.
So you have a pretty big class?
We've got 35 in the class, so it's a pretty good size group.
I think one of Ron's favorite parts of that's been going over and working with the juvenile detention group that the master gardeners go over and teach them things, and they grow vegetables up in big vegetable boxes there behind the court building, and pretty nice undertaking. I guess they've got their greenhouse up now.
Yes, they got that put up last year thanks to a grant from Voluntary Energy Corporation. Thank them for doing that, and nice little that, and they've got it down there so the wind doesn't blow it away too. That's
that's a good thing.
Put it up on top of that hill, and there's a little gust.
Yeah, up on top of the hill might be in a place where the wind got it. So they got it down in next to the building behind a fence there, and protects it from other people. So I think their classes were going to start this past Tuesday, and the weather got them. So I think it starts actually next Tuesday. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right. Thank you. Well, tell us about the history, somebody. I mean, tell us, you know,
how
of course, at my age,
in?
It's always been here. But, you know, I guess somewhere along the way it had to start. And so how old is the concept and how old is the one here in Bradley County?
Well, actually, Ron, what happened, I guess, back in 1862. You don't remember that, I don't think.
No, that was 3 years before my
time. Yeah, a little bit before your time. There was the good folks in the U.S. Congress passed an act called the Morrell Act. And what the Morrell Act did, it allowed for the creation of land-grant colleges. We've all heard about land-grant colleges, but we didn't know what that was. Well, the University of Tennessee was designated as a land-grant college. And so there was some other things that went along with that, but the Hatch Act followed it, and it was in 1887, and it gave federal funds from Congress to the each state land-grant university to create the experiment stations, and that's how they got started. The federal funds that they gave was $15,000 to each land-grant university, so that wasn't a whole lot. I guess it was a whole lot at that time, so a lot of money. But the bill was named for Congressman William Hatch, and it was connected in with the Morrell Act. And so in 1890, there was another addition to that Morrell Act, and it was aimed at southern states to create a second land-grant university, and that's where Tennessee State came in. They became our second land-grant university in Tennessee. Mm-hmm. So we now have a TSU position in Bradley County, and so that's the reason for our recent name change to UT/TSU Extension.
Oh, okay.
That's how we've got that name.
So,
but actually, the thing that started Extension itself was the Smith-Lever Act, and it didn't come along until 1914. Mm-hmm. And what it did is it established the Cooperative Extension Service, which connected the land-grant university and the counties and the farmers. The Hatch Act had the experiment station. We had all the research and information, but we didn't have any way to get it to the farmers. And so that's what the Smith-Lever Act did. It created the county staff and the people that actually got that information out to the farm.
So before that time, the farmers were just kind of on their own.
But now back 1910 or so in there, that's when the Girls Tomato Clubs and the Boys Corn Clubs and those things that actually started. And one of the very first extension agents that ever done that was here in Bradley County, and that was Miss Melissa Bird. And she was the one that worked with the girls on the tomato canning clubs. And she worked during the summer, I believe, of 1912 was what our history shows. That was her appointment time, and that's when all the tomatoes and everything was in season, and her job was to work with the girls in those.
Which was vitally important then.
Absolutely.
So it was more of an education, not just a club to go, hey, let's go put tomatoes in a jar.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it was to teach them how to do this.
And that was like Debbie said, that was vitally important to their livelihood and things that they could use for their food.
Mm-hmm. See, they couldn't freeze things then, so they had to know how to can.
There still wasn't a Walmart at that time, was
there?
No,
I don't think
you could go
there.
To Walmart and pick up canned tomatoes real quick. I think that wasn't there.
Yep. And then Mr. William J. Sanford came along in 1912, and he was the first agricultural agent. And his job was to work with the corn clubs and the farmers in the county.
What kind of things would the Boys Corn Club do?
Well,
what do you suspect?
Probably to teach them how to maybe grow corn and maybe increase yields and things like
keep the bugs out.
Yeah,
teaching them how to liquefy it.
No moonshining.
No.
Mr. Sanford.
How to turn it into a cash crop.
Yeah. In some of our history, we pulled out some things here. It says, Mr. Sanford, corn judging exercises for the boys was given. Mr. Sanford was in charge of all the agricultural work, soil problems, livestock, dairying, animal diseases, crop production and rotations, demonstrations, marketing, farmer organizations, and the corn clubs.
So, I think if you've never grown up on a farm, you just kind of think everything magically happens and everybody knows what to do. Well, they didn't necessarily know what to do. If a farmer moved in here from a different area, how we grew things and what you could grow here would be totally different, I think. So I'm sure that's one reason that it was so vitally important then.
And it said the corn clubs were organized in the county's four social centers. Ron, you reckon where those were?
The schools?
The four social centers. Zion Hill.
Mm-hmm. Is that the one on Keith Valley, you reckon?
Not sure. Tasso. Of course, we know where Tasso. Mm-hmm. And Prospect was another one. And then Black Fox.
Okay, that would be your four corners because Zion Hill's down on the south east side.
And it says a club was also outside these centers was organized at Liberty because of the interest in the programs that was offered. So,
in Liberty.
So, do you have an idea how many farmers there was at that time? Or, there was, a lot more because people still, that was the main.
That was, some people, that was the only occupation they ever had.
That, and of course, at that time, we had like Hardwick Clothes had developed. And so, there was some industrial jobs had started then, but everybody had a cow still, even 1910, even the city folks.
Absolutely. Yeah. I don't know how far we've got a bad problem at the office of not throwing things away, but I don't know how far back we've got the census records, but I know we've got them back into the 20s and 30s that was done, but
there were agricultural censuses done in the 1860s and 50s, I think, which are really interesting to go back and look at because it was the smallest farmers. You had those mammoth farmers, but the small farmers, too, that had two sheep and one pig, and this is how many cows they sold during the year, and it tells exactly what crops they grew and how much. So those are really interesting to look at, too.
Well, most of the farmers, though, were just to feed their families, right?
Pro- Probably so, and maybe sell a few things to buy salt and other things that they couldn't that they didn't have.
When did the strawberry crops start coming into Bradley County? I mean, there was a big craze there for. They started strawberry organizations, and they sold a lot of plants. I know P-Dab Matthews' family was big out here in the Prospect area.
Absolutely, and Paul Bancroft and Vernon Lackey and all of those. I'm not real sure. I'm sure that
it's been
documented.
About 1920, I think.
The Palmer family was involved in that.
And I think they even built a cooler here to cool, to freeze them and so they could ship them out. That's how big that became here.
There was even something that I was looking at in some of our history back day that I didn't realize Bradley County grew as many peaches as they did at one time. They were talking about shipping peaches out on rail cars. There were so many that was grown. And so that was, something that and I'm sure the strawberries worked its way in.
Well, and
that.
The cowpeas up in Charleston went out on the river was huge. Mm-hmm. I understand from Jack Sanders was huge.
Of course, a lot of things have changed. We don't grow cotton anymore either.
No.
So, but I know we did that because there was a cotton gin, I think, at Charleston at one time. So
I'm pretty sure there was more than one.
I've got some seeds. I'm going to grow cotton just to see it grow. I mean, I remember seeing the fields, but never really picked cotton or been around it. So I just want to see it grow.
We did that one year and my kids took it to, they went to school at Prospect and they took a plant to the school and it was, kids had never seen that before. And it's something else. And I know there are some teachers that here in Bradley County that do things like that and, grow things that we don't do and peanuts and that sort of thing.
Deb and I went down to Vicksburg last year and there were still a lot of cotton fields in Mississippi. It was pretty interesting to see those big white fields.
And I just didn't get your regular cotton balls to get the seeds out of. I took them off of a plantation. National Park Service plantation. I don't know if they would approve that or not. Whoops. It looks like this one has one cotton ball too many on it. Cotton bowl or whatever they call it. And I found out real fast that you had to be careful where you grab those little things.
Yeah.
All right, girls. Kim's gone. He's done his spiel for a few minutes. Let's ask you girls about 4-H. First of all, Catherine. Yes. I want to call you Kathy. Catherine.
That's okay.
Tell the folks what you do in the school system.
Okay. I am a program assistant. I've getting close to 18 years.
Wow. It doesn't seem possible.
I know.
Because I remember when you used to come to my fourth grade class.
We go in the classroom and we teach a variety of different things. And that's changed even in the 18 years I've been there, mm-hmm. where we used to go in and we do a cornbread contest. Mm-hmm. Well, we do not do that any longer.
Do you not do that anymore?
We do not.
That was my favorite thing in the fourth grade was the cornbread contest.
Where the room smells like cornbread all day long.
Well, if you think about it, families do not cook a lot anymore anyway. Mm-hmm. But we try to stay with the curriculum with the teacher. We're there to help them. Mm-hmm. With their curriculum now, or we might not be in the classroom anymore. Mm. Fourth grade, we do Tennessee history.
Good.
Like this month, we're talking about African Americans in Tennessee.
Good.
Mm-hmm. We do, fifth grade, we do natural resources. We have a program and we work with soil conservation with that. Like we do one on watersheds and then we do one on soil. Wildlife, that's one we're in right now. Then we, at the end of the year, we do one on birds, which is just fun because the kids identify, with yard birds and things mm-hmm. like that. Sixth grade, we're doing life skills and communication. Mm-hmm. So, of course, that ties in with our public speaking, which we're in the middle of right now. Mm-hmm. We might hear around 3,000 speeches. Sometimes some years it's more
better
than
others.
Yeah. But almost every fourth and fifth and sixth grader in Bradley County, we hear a speech from now. So that's part of the curriculum.
Well, the teachers make it part of the curriculum.
It is.
And it needs to be. It needs to be. And sometimes you find a hidden jewel, a little shy kid that you don't think would horrify them to get up and speak, and then they get up and they can.
That's one of the joys of this job is watching those children develop what they might not have done any other way.
Yes.
So, and then seventh grade, we're doing citizenship. We talk a lot about, this month we're talking about Bradley County.
Good.
Then and now. Mm-hmm. So we have some pictures of things around the Cleveland, and they have to see if they can identify them. Mm-hmm. So Woolen Mill is one of those.
Right.
Then in the seventh grade, we're doing leadership. We're talking about what type of leader mm-hmm. are they, mm-hmm. what to, how to become a good leader. So this is some of the things we do in the classroom now. So
basically, you're out in the schools almost every day the school's open.
Oh, yeah. And we're way behind.
Yeah. Well, it's no, you know, I'm sure that people who aren't in education, an occasional snow day is a good thing, but when you get this many in a row, it really knocks a hole in
what
you can get.
We're about 40 clubs behind.
Uh-huh. Well.
And that's not going to be able to make up a lot. Uh-huh. We're doing our speech contest, one of our sub-counties, tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So
tomorrow?
On Sunday.
On a Sunday. Well, yeah. That's unusual.
I won at Oak Grove speech contest.
Well, good
4-H.
For you. What was your speech on?
John Wilkes Booth.
Cool.
Sure was. And then I got to come to, the county competition.
Mm-hmm. We have two sub-counties.
I was trounced at the county competition, though, I have to admit.
We hear a lot of speeches, and a lot of good ones. I'm impressed with some of the ones we hear.
But the cornbread, that's just disappointing. There's no more cornbread.
Well, we are having a fun day at the mall in April, and we will be having bread baking contest there. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to put it back
I'm
in.
A pretty good judge. I just...
They just look
just
at them.
Just a
wrong.
Hint
they don't
there.
They don't eat them. And,
no, we don't.
Robert,
no, you got to eat it.
You got to taste it, don't you, Ron?
Just because it looks good doesn't mean it's good.
My grandmother had taught me how to get the pan real hot, and you pour mm-hmm. the mix in there, and it makes that good crust. Well, then when Ashley cooked her cornbread, it was judged as having too much crust on it. Now we went, you can never have too much crust on cornbread.
Amen.
Robin, so you do the same thing as Catherine, or do you do something different?
We all
get your microphone.
Swing the microphone.
Sorry, they have to. They're like bluegrass singers down there. They have to share one microphone.
We all pretty much do the same things. Catherine's a program assistant, and she does a lot of developing the programs. I'm an agent now. Now, I was a secretary there for 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Use your microphone.
So I have only actually been a 4-H agent for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I'm still learning the ropes and all that stuff. But
what's your favorite part of that job?
Well,
and it's not an easy job.
It's not an easy job because you have so many things that you're required to do through the university and our state programs and regional programs and all that kind of stuff, trying to keep everything, you know, up. But
move it closer.
I don't know. Surprisingly, I had dreaded going to camp. I had been told camp is horrible. You don't get any sleep. You're out in the... You know, with all these kids. But actually, camp has been one of my more favorite things. Mm-hmm. So, and at my age, I was surprised myself.
I got tickled. Our daughter, which it's got to have been over 15 years ago when she went. First year she went, and the second year she went, she started looking for a box fan. She was not used to roughing it with no air conditioning.
Camp is not like that
camp
anymore.
Camp is not like that anymore.
They have air conditioner now.
Yeah. That was her big thing. If she could just sleep at night with a fan, she'd be all right.
Well, now we still go do some camps. Camp, the Appalachian Camp, we do in Polk County, Adventures in Appalachia. It's at Camp McCroy. Now, Camp McCroy is still a rustic camp.
Mm-hmm.
They do have indoor plumbing. That's about it. You know, there's no.
Hey,
no,
we women have our priorities. Kim's over here laughing, but we have our priorities.
Well,
if it flushes, we'll go.
The first time that I went was in July, and we did a special little session on Civil War type things, and, you know, I do reenactment type stuff from time to time.
And that was actually a Civil War camp.
It was a conservation.
But before
CCC camp.
It was a CCC camp, but the soldiers actually camped on those grounds, too.
I did not know
that. I'm pretty sure of that. Well, we need to check our Polk County history book.
Need to check your Polk County
history book. But that flies into my head as being the truth.
It could be.
It would be the perfect place. There's water there. There's flat land. Mm-hmm. It was on a main road. So there you go.
The dam wasn't there then, though. Mm-hmm.
No. Well, that was in July, and after having all that garb on in the middle of July, and it was so hot. And it, at night, in the cabins, they're just block cabins, and we did have a fan, but I thought, I'm never, ever, ever going to get cool again. Mm-hmm. But then when we went back in October,
you got cool.
For our other camp, a leadership camp, we had a sudden drop in temperature, and it was in the 30s, and there's no heat either in the cabins. And I did get cool. So, you know, I've
that pendulum swings both ways.
It sure does.
I've seen Robin teach a class on herbs and things at the junior gardening class, and I think I learned more than the kids did that day. So I was sitting there going, okay, let me write this down. That's pretty good.
Yeah. So. And interesting, we have had some interest in the community and the general 4-H of kids wanting a junior master gardener class.
Good.
So we're going to be working.
You're quiet. I'm sorry.
Sorry. We're going to be working this spring to do a gardening workshop.
Good.
With fourth to sixth graders, and see what kind of response we get. We've started some new clubs this year, some very interesting clubs. We've started a dog club. That one has been very popular. We've got a sewing club that's running about 18 kids and quite a few parents coming in to help with that. We've got rabbit club. Catherine does rabbit club. Shooting sports. Lynn Middleton's into the shooting sports. We do archery, shotgun, and what's the other one? Archery, shotgun, and
Air rifle.
Air rifle.
Yeah,
yes.
Air rifles.
So we've got kids into that. So we've got a good variety, even a model car club.
Hey,
has started.
Wonderful. Yeah. Robin, tell everybody a little bit about your involvement in the United Daughters of the Confederacy. I've seen this woman dressed up out in the hottest days of the year and rain, no matter what, and she's doing her little spiel for history. But just to tell them a little bit about the club there and what you guys hope to accomplish.
Okay. I hadn't been prepared to think about that
well,
this morning, so I'll have to think a minute.
I know you
change
bleed
gears.
Gray, so it's okay. You'll
I do, in fact. I work with the Jefferson Davis chapter of the United Daughters of the Confederacy, chapter 900. And that group has been in organization for, I think they started in 1906, something like
real
that.
Early like
yes.
that.
So
it may have been on the 50th anniversary, somewhere around there. Maybe a little bit before, I don't remember.
Well,
and I'm letting you tell this story, so I'm going to be quiet.
We had the monument rededication a couple of years ago in 11, and that was the 100th anniversary of that monument. It's its 100th birthday. So
it's way on back there. Okay.
Yes, it is. And they started out trying to help soldiers and widows of soldiers to improve their life. And to at that time, there was a lot of graves and things that were not marked, and a lot of history that was being lost. So that was one of the missions of the Daughters of the Confederacy, was to come in and mark those graves, get a hold of that history so it would not be lost. Mm-hmm. And basically, we're doing the same thing today. Mm-hmm. We're still marking graves. We're still cleaning and repairing monuments and graves and stuff, and trying to keep the history, you mm-hmm. know,
now,
alive.
To become a member, you have to have... family members that served in the Confederacy, right?
Yes, you do. You can be a lineal descendant, which would be, you know, a direct bloodline, mm-hmm. or if you had a great uncle or right. something like that.
And folks who can't prove that lineage are more than welcome to participate in everything.
Yes. As a matter of fact, we have just
opened. You have lots of members.
We have just opened the chapter for associate members.
Okay.
And it is by invitation, and they are voted on and all that, but we've got our first two men associates.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty good, because, you know.
But they're alive and well here in Bradley County and doing good deeds, and I think that marking the graves are the most important thing. And it's a little bit harder now because you have to have somebody in the family request those markers.
Absolutely.
So that means that you guys are on Facebook tracking people down.
Absolutely. And it's harder to get documentation anymore. Used to, we could send off and get anybody's birth certificate or death certificate. You can't do that anymore.
It's much harder. Folks, you're listening to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9. We're talking about the UT TSU Agricultural Extension Office and its history. Huh?
That's a good job.
I won't be able to do that again. We got Catherine Irwin, although she didn't write it up right over here. Robin.
Irvin.
Did I say that?
Irvin.
Irvin.
We got
country. Robin Ramsey and Kim Frady. And here we're going to open the phones up. And something that will be coming up here very soon is we'll do Make It Grow again here on Whoop FM, which is a part of this the Master Gardeners program. And we'll have Master Gardeners come in for about 4 weeks. For about 45 minutes on Saturday morning before we do Old Town Cleveland and talk about your spring planting needs and getting ready to put all those crops in the ground. And that could be coming up as soon as next weekend. I don't know. We've got to get it. We just hadn't been able to get the everyone together, but we're ready to do that again. And like I say, that'll be about a four part. It could be up five or six parts. Who knows however they want to do it. We're ready to do that. The Junior Master Gardener Program, which is a part cooperation with the juvenile court systems, young men and young women who've got into a little trouble, who are given an option: go stay in the facility or come and garden with us, and they have to successfully graduate that and attend. And
most of them do.
Pretty amazing that, you know, some get there, have no idea that a carrot comes out of the ground and how things, and it's pretty miraculous some of the things that grew last year. I got to help in the fall project, and it was, they grew some really amazing things there. We're going to open up the phones here. You can call us here at 614-5553 if you got a question or a comment here this morning.
Let's see if Kim can tell us the courthouse story while we're waiting on our first caller.
Well, I can do that. I think I can tell you a little bit about it. But before we go there, we've got Robin and Catherine here, but there's actually 9 people that work at the extension office.
And I've expanded over the years.
I think we probably need to introduce them. Lynn Middleton is one that is not here, and Lynn's our other 4-H agent. She's doing shooting sports today and would have loved to have been with us, but we have Stephanie Holden, who is a part-time program assistant. She helps meet 4-H club meetings in the schools and other things that we need her to do. Kay Smith. Kay was our senior agent and still is, because she's retired, but yet we've got her back 20 hours a week to do some of the family and consumer science programs that she's always done. Kathy Hayes is a program assistant with a 10-SEP program, and that stands for Tennessee Nutrition Consumer Education Program. And she works with Head Start and WIC families and that sort of thing with nutrition items and information about that. And of course, Janet Bunch is our administrative assistant, and she does all of our work, and most everything we couldn't do without her. She's a real, real great one to have, and does anything we ask her to do. So she's really
we
good.
We have another agent too, don't we?
Yeah. I skip. He's below me. I don't know exactly where he's doing a program. I asked him if he wanted to come today in my place, but Patrick Sweat is our newest agent. He's the TSU agent, and he's doing a program this morning. He texted me back.
Patrick come in and did one of our Make It Growth with. Yep. Let's take this call here real quick. Good morning, live on Old Town Cleveland.
Hey, it's Johnny. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Doing great. I just wanted to give a plug for Master Gardeners.
Go right ahead.
So I had been adding up some figures. We started Master Gardener classes, or Kim did, in 1994. Now, there's some classes that I don't have accountable for, but this is just the numbers I have. I'm missing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm missing 7 classes that we don't have records on, but we have... Well, my total for the ones, even without those 7, is 415 people have gone through the Master Gardener class. Wow. This is an awesome number for Bradley County.
Johnny, I can get you all but 3. The 3 that I don't know, we'll have to dig out of our paperwork because my computer crashed and I lost 3 years. But I can get you the others, but I'd say we're well over 500.
Yeah, I know we are. I want to put a plug in, too. We had our Master Gardener Winter School in Murfreesboro this weekend, And what was so great about this, there is an award giving for, it's called Search of Excellence. And our junior master gardener class group, Deb Flower, Leslie Humbert, and Ricky Talent, Faith Sharp, I can't name all of them, but everybody that worked in that received the highest award. It's called the Search of Excellence. It's called the Golden Shovel Award. And I went over Wednesday night before the snow, Deb and Dave Flower. So we got to be there to see the award. We missed about seven people that were going to come over on Thursday, but we were fortunate that Patrick got to come over on Friday. So, you know, everybody, it was so neat to see all these county people, all these master gardener people and agents coming up and asking questions about our juvenile court program. It was just, you know, it just made you feel good because we've only been, our Master Gardener organization has only been started since 2012. And this is almost unheard of for you to win an award that soon and to be, we're probably one of the smallest, we have a lot of people that have taken the class, but in our organization we're not real big. So that's what I want to do today. If anybody has taken the Master Gardener class and think, oh, well, I haven't got my hours in, please call Kim, and we can work with you and help you get your hours in. We need people to help us in our Master Gardener organization. We've got these projects, and after going to the school, I am pumped. I am ready to do this Master Gardener thing upright. So we need help.
Some of us need to enter our hours.
Yeah.
Of us need to enter our hours.
But, Ron, I can also...
I'll help you do that, Ron. You know that.
Yeah.
If you took the class before and hadn't done it, I can grant amnesty on some of that stuff.
Well,
so they could start over.
I've actually did things, just haven't wrote it down
well,
yet.
You need to enter those things in before Johnny whips you.
Yes.
Hey, Johnny.
Yes, ma'am.
This is Debbie. I have an opportunity for some of the gardeners to get some community hours, I'm sure. Up in Charleston by the Cypress Grove, they are going to put in a natural plant area, a garden. They have gotten a grant for it.
I heard about that.
Okay, and they need folks that know how to plant stuff to come help them.
I talked to Teresa. Help me out. Teresa Horn. She's involved in this, and she's one of our Master Gardener interns. She's taken the class, and she's
okay.
Sent an email on this.
Okay, but they definitely, we were at a Charleston historical meeting, and they announced that, and I thought Master Gardeners is a perfect fit for that.
Exactly, and they're wanting to do native plants in that, which is
yes.
Right up my alley. We need to plant more native plants in Bradley County.
And I don't know if this is Teresa or not, but the lady that's actually in charge of it has just retired from TVA.
Exactly.
And she's a natural plant nut. And so she is coming up with the design and stuff. They're just needing people that know how to really plant things or can follow directions well.
I'll get that name from you, and we'll get in touch with her because we have a lot of people in our group that are into native plants.
Okay, good deal. Perfect fit.
Exactly. Now Kim is letting me do in our Master Gardener class, we get to present one class on native plants. So I'm really excited about this to teach people why we need to plant native plants in Bradley County.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
She's on the program Monday night, Ron, with Dave Hopper, where Dave's going to talk about composting, and he calls it vermiculture. I call it wormaculture. So.
Wormology. Yeah,
and Johnny's going to do her native plants talk, and she does an excellent job with that.
When you guys want to start the radio show, Make It Grow, we can start as early as next Saturday or whenever you want to start.
Okay, you give me a call, give me a call, and we'll get with you and Faith to get this together because we do need to get this rolling. We wanted to get it started in March.
We're ready.
Okay.
And next week is March.
Okay,
already. Unbelievably.
I don't know if she's listening today, as she may be working, but we do want to get this started. So everybody needs to know that Bradley County Master Gardeners does the Make It Grow show. So, but. Really, my emphasis today is to get those Master Gardener people, everyone that's taken the Master Gardener class, to please contact the office. What's the number, Ron?
728.
728-1000? No.
728-7001.
I was close.
You were close.
He was dyslexic.
Yeah.
Ron will tell everybody, that's one of our questions on our Master Gardener test, so we all have to know that.
That was the one I got right.
And it doesn't really like that everybody knows the extension number, but we all know our extension number. So we're very fortunate to have an extension that believes in master gardeners. We're excited about Patrick. He was at our school, our winter school, and Kim's right there with us. So, you know, we want to grow. Next time when we go to winter school, we want to have 15 to 20 people there representing Bradley County. So maybe the weather will cooperate and we can. So, but anyway.
I say Tennessee's the only place that you can have shorts and long johns in the wash, in the same load of wash.
Exactly. What's it going to get like next week? Like right now, I'm looking at the Weather Channel. It says Wednesday it's going to be 60. And this is weird.
Yep. So. All right, Johnny, I'll get a hold of you.
All right. Thank you, Ron. Y'all have a great day.
All right. Bye-bye. You can call us here at 614-5553 if you got a question about the agriculture. If you have a question about gardening, I bet somebody probably even answered that today.
Absolutely. One thing we'd like to do too, Ron, is we go into this growing season this year, we'd like to get a couple of master gardeners to maybe a couple of days a week, like a Monday and a Wednesday, to come in and be there if you've got a gardening question.
It'd be great.
To call in and get an answer for it.
Right. Good morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Yes, sir. This is Greg Brackett from over here at Old Fork. Kind of a two-part call. First thing is to say good morning to Kim. Been a while since I've got to speak to him.
Hey, Greg.
And the second part, I'm glad that y'all are supporting this garden type thing. I have a side interest in it because I try to keep a few honeybees. And it would be surprising if you could find you a beekeeper, local beekeeper, to maybe set up a hive close by to help pollinate everything that the people are trying to grow. And you would be surprised at the increase in production of different fruits and vegetables and such just by having a local hive close by.
Definitely fruit trees, apple trees, and peach trees, those are very important, aren't they?
Yes, they are. And, of course, your bees, anything that's got nectar or honey, pollen, they'll come to it and help pollinate everything. So I just thought I'd add that little comment there and say good morning to Kim.
Well, good morning, Greg. Thanks for calling. I've known Greg's family a long, long time. And that beekeeping is... It's gotten a lot more complicated lately with all the insects and things that attack the hives and other things that you get. But he's exactly right. Apple Valley Orchard will actually bring hives of bees in during pollination time to do the trees. And I think maybe Mike Brown does that at Charleston in the cantaloupe and watermelon fields. Around the edges, they'll put up some beehives.
I know in the Master Gardeners class, we also had a portion on beekeeping. Pretty interesting.
It's very surprising how one aspect of it supports another aspect that you may not even think of.
That's right.
So I just thought I'd add that comment in this morning and enjoying y'all.
Thank
show.
You.
And keep up the good work.
Thank you. Bye bye. I know that we've had the bee lady on here from the Appalachian Bee. Appalachian Bee. Something. And matter of fact, I had invited her in.
Her website's Honeybees Rock.
Honeybeesrock.com. It sure is. And she talks about renting her hives out, that she takes them around, and Apple Valley Orchards has been in the past, I think, one of her customers, which I didn't know you could rent your bees.
Mm-hmm. Well, another thing that Extension does, I know when I worked as secretary and answering the phone, we have a lot of people in the area who will actually have honeybees move in to odd places.
Swarms.
On their property.
On the front of their cars.
Exactly. We don't, want to destroy those things, and people in Bradley County are very conscientious of that, so they'll call the Extension office, and we have a list of beekeepers who will actually go out and
gather
those. They can't do it if it's swarms. Inside a wall, or a home structure, but that's a really good service our beekeepers have for
Absolutely.
Us, too.
Or 50 foot up in a oak tree, it's kind of hard to get to those. But if it's where they can get to them and capture them, they those are native bees that somehow have missed all the mite problems and those kinds of things. And
there is a couple of beekeeping organizations in the area, aren't they? One, the Okoye Valley Beekeepers, I believe, and
Cherokee Beekeepers, and then there's one down in Chattanooga area. I think it's the Tri-State Beekeepers Association, but they actually meet in Chattanooga there somewhere, maybe at the extension complex there on Bonnie Oaks Drive.
So let me ask you real quick, if somebody wants to start planting something, what can you plant right now?
Oh, I would say after the snow's gone, I think probably.
Now, you know this is the third day the snow's been on the ground, and my daddy always said when the snow was still on the ground 3 days after the snow, it was waiting around for the next one.
Exactly.
I don't care if it's going to be 60 Wednesday.
It's scary. I don't know. But any of the cool season crops, we need to start thinking about. If
onions,
you know,
potatoes.
Onions, potatoes, lettuce, radishes, you know, English peas, anything that can withstand some frost and not. And you know, you could do potatoes too, but, you know, if they do come break the ground before frost's over, it's going to bite them back. Probably won't kill them, but it'll bite them back, so.
But I will tell you one thing, this is a great time of year to do your soil samples. You know, get your soil samples in and have your testing done so you'll know what nutrients that need to be added to your soil to have a real productive garden this year.
And what you need to do, just go by the extension office and pick up a little kit, and there's some instructions to do that. And there's a cost, it's a small cost, and they will actually evaluate your soil. And if you're wanting to grow grass, they can tell you what you need to put in there for that. And then if you want to grow corn, if you want to grow watermelon, they can give you breakdown by what you want to grow. So
ornamentals, flowers, anything like that. The cost is $7, but it'll be the best $7 you ever spent, because you could go out there and we can look at the soil and say, yeah, that probably needs fertilized, but it may not. You can go out and dump a lot of fertilizer. Well, doesn't take a lot of fertilizer to make $7 anymore.
Yeah.
So fertilizer is probably the...
And the one thing that the soil, plants do not eat soil. The soil is what contains what the nutrients that they eat. And so, and our soil in Bradley County is not extremely deep, unless you live on a river bottom somewhere. And so we have to add to our soil to make it better. Some of you have put compost on your leaves. You know, Ken Roark down in McDonald area. I don't know how many tons of leaves he must put on his garden spot. Turned it over, and of course this year, every year he produces an unbelievable garden. I'm envious of him. So, but you do have to add something to your soil, and if you want to grow a particular crop, if you're a large corn grower, you have agents that go out and will help them who produce mass stuff. If you're just growing a home garden, you still need to spend your $7.
So, absolutely.
You know, but if you want to plant 20 acres of corn, Ken will probably come out. I mean, Ken will come out and help you, or Patrick will come out and give you a little bit more of that. And I'm sure people like Clayton Beatty has a few suggestions also.
Oh, absolutely.
And does a very good job also.
Very knowledgeable.
Yes.
He's a good source to go to.
So, over the years, who have been the agents here in town? I remember Mr. Hale.
Probably everybody will remember Mr. Hale. I think there was a Mr. Schaus maybe before him, and I think he was during maybe during the wartime.
Yeah, he was 1920 to 1939.
Yeah,
but you had William J. Sanford. He was in the early years.
He was the first one. Yep.
G. L. Harris was 1917 to 18. James B. McKenzie was 1918 to 20. Schaus was 1920 to 39. He's the first person to stay long term,
right.
Notice. Mr. J.W. Cate was a 1935 assistant in soil erosion control, which was a big thing then because the whole western part of the United States was blowing away at that time.
And we said,
did something wrong. We need to pay attention to this. Then from 1935 to 1950 was W.W. Smith. 1953 to 1979, that was a big stay, was Mr. Hale. And then Mr. Paysinger was 1955 and retired in 1982.
Now, Mr. Smith, he was a part of a program that was started. It was called the Unit Test Demonstration Program. And what it was a cooperation between the university and TVA. That's when fertilizers were first starting to get developed and everything. And so they worked, went out, and they gave a, it seemed like they had like four or five farms per county that they did individual assistance with. Mr. Smith would be there once a week or something like that to see how progress and how you were doing, and as far as varieties and fertilizers and things that, that he might be able to help you with. And he was one of ours. Bob Sliger was another one. Bob worked here for 3 or 4 years and then went on to be the county agent in Monroe County. And so that program eventually turned into what we have now called a MANAGE program. And MANAGE program has kind of grown into more financial management type things. Farmers that are interested in expanding their operations maybe, or building a new barn or something like that, we have an agent that's specifically for that can come in. And of course, technologies with the computers and that sort of things run programs and tell you, for instance, if you're a dairyman and you want to build a new barn and you're milking 150 cows, if you want to build this new barn, they'll tell you, well, you're going to have to milk 180 cows or whatever to pay for that additional structure.
In Bradley County, what is the biggest crop that we have now that we actually produce?
Probably, as far as crops go, probably corn is still the
now, is that
top.
For
soybeans,
feed corn, or does it just feed corn, or do we?
Some is harvested for grain. More is harvested for grain now probably than used to be. Used to, a lot of our corn was chopped and went into silage for the dairy farms. But we only have like 9 dairies in the county now. So when I came back in 1983, we had 45. So we've really decreased in numbers. Soybeans
is enough to encourage them.
Yeah.
Well, it's the marketplace, isn't it?
To a certain degree, but also families. Also, you know, kids grew up on the farm and saw how hard mom and dad had to work. And, hey, I'm going to town and I'm going
to
get
work
me a
9
job.
To 5.
Well, some developer comes in there and offers you an unbelievable amount for the farm. You go, well, I love it, but, you know, there's a subdivision coming.
And that's happened, too.
Yes.
You know, growth of the county has done some of that. So there's a lot of different things that's happened. You know, market has mm-hmm. influenced some. That's, you know, milk price got real low to the farmer. And, hey, I'm going to sell my cows and quit and go into the beef cattle business. Mm-hmm. And a lot have done that. We've not really decreased the number of total animals, but we've decreased the number of dairy cows. But then we've also got some large dairies, Hatchers in Polk County, and Rex Calfee's milking probably over 600 cows.
I was amazed to learn that his cows had barcodes. Mm-hmm. And as they walk into the bar, it reads the barcode, and you know exactly how much milk each cow gives, which is... And that's high-tech farming
there's more something high-tech than that. Terry Bishop in Polk County actually has robots milking the cows. He has robotic milkers. Cows walk in, and the robot senses where the cow's teats are, and they're washed and everything.
You learned it here first on Old Town Cleveland, milking
the
cows.
The robot don't care if the tail smashes it whatsoever. It doesn't bother that tail. How many milk cows in Bradley County, Polk, are they? I mean, do you have a guesstimate?
Don't really have a good number. I'd say probably between 2,000 and 2,500. A lot of times when other farms have gotten larger, like the Moores up in on Dry Valley, John Moore and Jack and Jim Moores on the other side, on the west side of Dry Valley Road, they've actually increased cow numbers. And so they've kind of, when they increase, they kind of make up for some
now,
of the
Now, are Jack and Jill related to John?
They are, but I'm not sure.
Not like a son.
No.
No.
Distant related, just like the Moores in Bradley County, you know.
I break them into two groups, the dairy farm Moores and the other Moores.
My great-grandfather lived on John Moore's farm.
Really?
But don't
so
know
we
that,
figured
we
they
don't
were probably
know that
related.
We're related. We can't tie that. But they probably all come out of North Carolina down the river, and that's where they got there. But he actually lived there near Rattlesnake Springs.
But now John Moore's family was there when Bradley County opened up. And then Ron's family came early 1900s.
Well, and then you've got Howard Moore that's down on Lead Mine Road, and I'm sure they're related somehow, but I don't know how. No. Howard's one of the very few that still has an all Jersey herd. Hanna Brothers down on Dalton Pike have Josh got involved in showing some shorthorn, so they've got a couple of milking shorthorn in the herd, but Howard's still all Jersey.
How big's their herd, the Hanna boys? Let me say it right, like my papa used to say, the Hanner boys.
Hanner boys.
He said, I used to pick peaches down on the Hanner boys farm, or at the Hanner farm.
They're probably milking about 125 cows. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, our medium-sized farms, that's kind of what they shoot for.
It's a 100-year farm, too, isn't it?
Century farm.
That's what.
Well, and that family's been there before the Bradley County opened also.
And that's something else. We've got a lot of farms in Bradley County that are century farms that have not gone through the and been documented. Mm-hmm. And we need to, there's a lot of those we need.
There's a lot of them getting close that they could be gathering the stuff now. I know that the farm that I grew up on, it's 1920. So they're getting close to that.
So soybean, they ship the soybean out, or is that?
Yes.
Okay.
They go, normally goes to feed mills. Some goes to oil production for soybean oil that we buy at the grocery store. But a lot goes to the feed mills that make, you know, and it's made into animal feed.
So who's the biggest grower of soybean around, would you guess?
Oh, golly. I don't know. Ed Campbell down on Lead Mine Road. Ed's got several. The Rollins family over in Rollinsville. They've got a lot, that's the area over there. Everybody's either a Rollins or married one.
You know where the Rollins live at? Go around
White Oak Valley Road.
White Oak Valley Road and take a left. Right down there.
Okay. And they got the old Rollins house out there, don't they? I mean, the original house from Civil War times, I think, or before.
Yeah.
They've invited me out there. I just haven't made it yet.
So what about vegetable crops? Do we have anybody, you know, Mr. Brown? We know Mr. Brown.
He's probably our largest, but we've got a lot of small fruit and vegetable growers, and a lot of them sell at our farmers markets.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, they'll bring things in, and it may be, you know, an acre or two, or it may just be a backyard garden, and they have more than they use. And that's really what the market on Peerless Road was started.
And it needs to be, when I buy stuff at the farmers market out on Peerless, are all those people growers, or some of them are middle people?
What we did this year is we went through and issued grower permits. And if you didn't have a grower permit, you weren't supposed to be there selling.
That's good.
And so, you know, most everybody is legitimate that's there. It comes from their place. You know, of course, there'll be some that'll sneak something in on us from time to time.
Mention that.
Now, you do not run the cannery, right?
It's through our office.
Okay.
Yes. That is the greatest kept secret ever. I mean, I know that we've had, help me with her name. Who's the lady out there?
Mary Lou.
It's been on our show twice.
Mary Lou.
Mary Lou. And she is absolutely a stick of dynamite, that girl is. And she loves that cannon, and she loves working with the people out there.
It's pretty amazing that what
I need to get her to adopt Ron, because I do not like cannon, and he likes to piddle in the kitchen.
Yes, I do.
What we do is we have, when you come into can, we have you fill out a card with your name and then you put on how much you can and everything. And we had 408 families that canned this year. Now, we don't know how many families that affected, because grandma may have come in and, you know, and canned, or a parent canned for her children also and passed it out. So we don't really know how many families who are affected, but we had that many folks canned. And it was a little over 22,000 jars of food that they canned, either fruits or vegetables.
Well, I did buy Ron a dehydrator this year, hoping to cut down on the canning activities at the house. But the very first thing he did was he dried hot peppers. And if you ever want me to leave the house, start burning them.
Fumes come off of that. Did you realize
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. I didn't know
toxic
that.
Fumes.
Oh, there. And then I ground up the dried ones.
And I'm like standing
and
looking
I was sitting there going, Oh, my God.
And looking at the dehumidifier.
I learned my lesson there.
I was standing there looking at the dehydrator going, is it finished? So, it's making my eyes water.
Tobacco is not a big crop product in this
area
now.
Not so much anymore. Now, what tobacco's done, used to we had tobacco houses where if you were a tobacco grower, you harvested your tobacco and took it to the tobacco house. And Philip Morris or R.J. Reynolds or American
Tobacco.
There
used
to be
one up in Sweetwater, I believe.
Right.
My brother-in-law's daddy used to run that barn up there.
Right. And what they've done now is they've gone more to a company producer relationship, kind of like an integrator with chickens, where you know the company will bring you chickens and feed, and you're the one that takes care of them. Well, tobacco's kind of gone that way too. They'll tell you that ask you to grow a certain variety. We want you to grow this variety because this variety is what makes a Winston taste like a Winston. And then they'll buy their bulk tobacco on the world market and then contract with you to grow this variety. And Mike still does that. Mike Brown still does that some in the Charleston area.
That was the first time in years I had actually seen tobacco hanging in sheds and barns and was still on the wagon is that I happened to go take a friend of mine from Oklahoma that was here visiting up to Charleston to show the historic things. And we turned around at the Brown farm, and he had tobacco everywhere. And we were all so excited because she had not seen that either. And then we had to look at his Zonkey.
Yep.
He's got a zebra Zonkey calf. And it's not a calf.
Mixed.
It's a colt, I guess. And it was pretty interesting to see that little creature.
But actually, that's been good for the tobacco growers in a sense, because the companies will pay you a premium price for that variety that they want you to grow.
And so orchards, Apple Valley?
Oh, we're very diverse. We've got fruits. We've got a Marsh Vineyard and winery up in Charleston area, Apple Valley. We've got a nursery that also helps in the county. We've got Swalford's and Black Fox Farm, which they grow a lot of container plants that's shipped everywhere in the United States.
Okay. Hey, folks, we're going to take a break. We'll be back here in just a few minutes every week.
We remember Dr. Spock died from Star Trek, and he's someone that everybody recognized. And, of course, we lost Miss Gaynell Humbert. She was 99 years old, and she had taught at the number 4 school and Valley View School for 40 years. I had her in third grade, and she was from the Sugar Creek community. And she and Ron Coons' father passed, and I wanted everybody to know that.
And so every week we play a song at the end of the commercials called Gone Home, and dedicate that to all the family members and friends and relatives in our community that have gone. And we'll be back right after this word here on Old Town Cleveland.
You are listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Hello, this is Josh Weekly with the Bald Headed Bistro. And now that the weather is turning cold, we want to invite you down to enjoy some great new winter options. Whether it's a birthday, anniversary, or just a night out of the town, come warm up with us in our amazing log cabin setting here at the Bald Headed Bistro.
Check into cash.
Turn your car into cash at Check Into Cash.
Get an auto title loan today for up to $2,500.
At Check Into Cash, you get the most for your car, and we make it quick, easy, and confidential.
Stop in for an auto title loan today or a payday advance for up to $425. Call toll-free 877-262-CASH.
Title loan amount determined by value of car and ability to repay. Borrowers often use payday advances over a period of months, which can be expensive. Restrictions apply. See store for details.
Hello, my name is Andy Figelstaller with Ed Jacobs & Associates. We are an employee benefit and insurance broker in business for the past 20 years. The new health care law, also known as Obamacare, has finally arrived. The law is complex and the choices are confusing. You have questions, we have the answers. It is our passion to find cost-effective solutions for every client. The solutions will be different for every person or business. Let our knowledge, experience, and passion go to work for you. Contact us today and let us assist you through this process. Our phone number is 423-473-0202, or you can find us on the web at edjacobs.com.
Check into, checking or cash?
The cash you need is closer than you think.
Get an auto title loan today for up to $2,500 at Checkin' to Cash.
You drive home with the cash in your pocket.
Visit Checkin' to Cash for an auto title loan today or get a payday advance for up to $425. Call toll-free 877-262-CASH. Title loan amount determined by value of car and ability to repay. Borrowers often use payday advances over a period of months, which can be expensive. Restrictions apply. See store for details.
If you need a little green, Lending Frog is making deals. He'll lend you cash on any kind of wheels. Borrow just a little, or you can borrow big. Lending Frog is a new financial gig. It's hip to hop, it's hip to hop into cash. LendingFrog.com is making a splash.
Dig it, dig it.
Welcome back to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9. You can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. You can call us here at 614-5553. Today we're talking about the UTTSU Agricultural Extension Agency here in Bradley County and the history of the agency and some of their activities and things that I didn't know about, and that's what we do this show.
I didn't know about.
There's a lot of things I don't know about. That's why we do this show mainly.
Well, I got a couple little announcements. Let me tell you, I've got
Kim Frady, Catherine Irwin, and Robin Ramsey here in today. So call us 614-5553. Deb, what do you got there?
I just wanted to say a happy belated birthday to Claude Ogle Sr. He is now 100 years and 1 week old. And he's been our guest on a couple occasions, and he just sings songs and has poems memorized.
He was born when they created the Extension Agency. He was there when they were both infants.
And then our good friend Fro will be at the Gypsy Rose tonight from 9:30 to 1:30. So be sure to go by and see Convertible with Fro. Also, next week's show, we have back by popular demand, and people have asked about him, wanting him to come back. It will be Charlie Rodamir, I believe is his name, from Sequoia Museum. And he's also going to be telling us about the vintage baseball team that he played on last year, where the guys went out in the authentic wool uniforms and played baseball. And he's also an expert on Fort Loudoun and its activities. So get those kind of questions ready for him. We've also launched a new music video. Ron, would you like to tell everybody about that?
Yes, from our documentary that we did, It's a Dirt Track Life, the song at the end of it was called The Finish Line. Well, we've actually done a music video now called The Finish Line. If you go on the internet, since there are a lot of things called The Finish Line, it's The Finish Line and the number one.
And it also helps to type Old Town Cleveland with that, and then it'll come up faster for you.
So be looking for that. If you go to Old Town Cleveland on Facebook, you can find that link on there also. And then if you'd like to join Old Town Cleveland on Facebook, too late. We have 5,000 members on there, and you can only have 5,000 members. So go to Friends of Old Town Cleveland, which is a group, and you can join the couple thousand people on that one. So,
and our first music video has hit 50,000 views.
So
it's a Dirt Track Life. Watch that one too. And we'd like to say good morning to our neighbors over at the Village Bake Shop. If you want something good to eat, go over there and get their world-famous thumbprint cookies.
And one other thing, my friend Jeff over at the Oasis, the Old Cafe, I used to go get my biscuit there a lot, but I hadn't been able to go there recently, but I'm going to have to stop in and see Jeff and get that biscuit over there at the Old Cafe, which is in the Oasis, right there as you go into the split at Inman and First Street. Go in there, and they've got frog legs and everything else in there. So go over there, and good morning, Jeff, if you're listening. Kim,
start with Catherine.
Which one are we going to talk
about? Let me finish up here. We were hitting, and then we've got another program that we Extension does. We've not even talked about yet. It's Family and Consumer Science. I think Robin's going to touch on those. Right. But what a lot of folks don't know, Ron, even with the growth and everything that we've had in Bradley County, we are still number one in East Tennessee in total agricultural sales of ag products in the state of Tennessee. And a lot of that, everybody said, well, how have we got that much ag sales? Well, poultry is the number one. That's probably half of that $100 million that we have annually is poultry. But cattle and dairying and the crops that we talked about, all of those contribute to that. So we are actually number three in the state of Tennessee in total ag product sales, number two in poultry. Bedford County's number one, and that's where the big Tyson hub is located in the Shelbyville area. So they're a little bit larger than Pilgrim's Pride, which is in Chattanooga. So
pretty much if you want a job in Bedford County, you have to be involved in chickens somehow.
Absolutely. It's kind of like Dalton in the carpet industry. Right. You got it's chickens in Bedford County.
Or McDonald's or the gas stations. That's about the limit there.
Absolutely.
I work with some people in Bedford County there. Okay. All right.
That's all I
want. Catherine, you're going to tell us about the history fair coming up, something we're very interested in.
Some of the projects that we still do in 4-H, and we talked about cornbread, we still, we do not do on a yearly project.
But if anybody wants to bring me cornbread, it's okay.
Hey.
I mean, I will still judge your cornbread, whether you're in a contest or not. I'm here from 10 to 12 on Saturday mornings. And
you want some pinto beans to go along with that, too?
Pinto beans would be great, too. And
cornbread and chili. You can't beat that.
Oh, yeah. Then you're talking about good cornbread and anything really good. Cornbread and butter, milk, you know, just.
Buttermilk. What's wrong? Go, ee.
Ooh, no buttermilk. And the cornbread, it's okay. But go ahead, Catherine.
Well, and April 11th, we'll be at the mall, and we'll be having, we're calling it an expo day or a fun day, and we'll have cornbread, biscuits, muffins, and decorated cupcakes kids can bring in. We'll have a piggy bank pageant, and that's not where you dress up a pig, but you make a bank. Mm-hmm. We do promote saving money in our classrooms, too. So they can, it's extra good when they can make it out of recycle something. So then we'll have a poster contest, degree poster contest will be during that time also, and photography. So, you know, some of the things we can't do in the classroom now, we are going to be having at the mall. One of the things we have at the mall is our 4-H Tennessee History Fair. We have it in November, but like this year, we had 174 kids involved.
Great.
And that's where they make an exhibit on a Tennessee project. Like sixth graders do history that made a difference. And that can be anything in Bradley County or in Tennessee. Seventh graders do historical Tennesseans. And then our 8th through 12th graders have been doing Tennessee the Civil War. And just talk about, they do the trifo boards. We have one, Sarah Tank did one this year on her project in 4-H is food science. So she did food during the Civil War. And so she actually, both sides, she made a tack and then the Johnny Cakes. And that's what her display was on. It was wonderful. We had just some excellent ones this year.
Now, you get all these through the school programs, right?
We do.
Okay. So grandparents, moms, dads, aunts, and uncles, ask your children about 4-H and get them more involved. It's, you know, it's a good thing to do. This is very, you know, math is good, all the other stuff is good, but all-rounded person, get involved in your community somehow by getting involved in 4-H. So talk to your kids about that.
And that's one of the things we do it to promote citizenship, by getting involved in your community, you know?
Let's get this call here real
quick. Okay.
Good morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Good morning. It's T-Bandy.
T-Bandy, how are you?
Hey, I finally got numbers and stuff written down. What's up, T?
Cornbread man of the South.
Cornbread, that's right.
Yeah, that's right.
No, I got a fish truck coming March the 7th.
Okay.
That's next Saturday down at the co-op.
Okay, and if people need to order fish, what number do they call?
478-2405.
Right.
And if you don't order, you can just show up and they'll have a tank full of fish, right?
If they've got them, you can get them. If they don't, you check.
Well,
better to order.
It's better to order than you get what you want.
Yeah, because I've got a bunch sold this time, so they'll be
good.
If nothing happens.
Okay, March 7th, 478-2405, if you need to order fish from the fish truck.
What kind of fish do they bring?
A catfish and a hybrid bluegill, black crappie, a fathead minnows, koi's, and grass carp.
Just about any fish you need.
Now, for you listening, this is not for fish fries.
This is buddy.
This is for
pond.
Your ponds and your lakes.
Now you can eat them.
Well, you can after they grow a little bit.
That's right.
Yeah, but
carp's big enough to eat.
Well,
they
I don't
have lips.
I don't know if I have eat carp or not though. But
well, they good.
Well, with cornbread, it'd be good, wouldn't it?
Anything.
With my cornbread, yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Good thing about those carp, T, is they're all vegetarians, aren't they?
Yeah, they're vegetarian. They don't multiply. They've been neutered.
That's interesting.
There's one job I didn't want.
Well, I think they do that by breeding, Ron. They don't physically.
Oh, okay. All right. Well,
they breed them to where they won't reproduce.
They put a needle in their throat.
Oh, well, see, I've watched that Dirty Job so many times, and all the things, some of the things he's had to do. I'm going, T, you used to help grow tobacco back up around John Moore's farm, didn't you?
Yeah, I've grown tobacco about everywhere we was at, Athens, and I could take a spear and spear for two people a cutting. I was pretty good at that.
Yeah. Yep.
So T actually lived in the house there at Rattlesnake Springs and done tobacco farming there.
Yeah.
Did you ever pick cotton, T?
I picked cotton for... I was raised with a tow sack behind me.
Dragging it on the ground.
Yeah, we had about 10 acres of cotton. From the time I was 7 years old up to I was 15 or 16.
Wow.
All right. Well, hey, thanks, T.
Thanks, T. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Right. Be careful, Tim.
All right.
Thank you, T.
Let me say something. T's called a couple of times to talk about this Black Fox Equestrian Center, and we didn't have contact information. Let me give that now. They do therapeutic riding for disabled children, and they're down on Black Fox Community on Tunnel Hill Road. And the horses, this is a voluntary type thing. They took their training. They provide the horses. They provide everything. But they need some help feeding those horses. And, you know, they're not, it's just a fact of life that this time of year you got to have hay. And $4 will buy a bale of hay. If you'd like to donate, I'm going to give you a couple of phone numbers here and an address. First is the address. It's Steve Petit, P-O-T-E-E-T, Steve Petit, at 1223 Tunnel Hill Road, Cleveland, Tennessee, and I believe that's 37311. It's 1223 Tunnel Hill Road, 37311, Steve Petit. You can just send him a little check. Every $4 will help. Or if you'd like to call them, the number is 423-505-2215. And the name of the program is called Spirit Horse. And they're doing an excellent service for this community. And I hope that our listeners will support them. You can tell them you heard about it here on Old Town Cleveland. Again, it's Spirit Horse at 423-505-2215.
If everybody sent $4, they'd have a lot of hay.
They'd have
you
a lot of hay.
You send them $20, we'll take care of that.
I'm going to send them a little money because I think that taking care of disabled children is a very important thing. Catherine, live radio, we're coming back to you.
All right. next month we'll be doing demonstrations in the classroom. Did you do a demonstration? It's a how-to.
Made a volcano because every fourth grader made a volcano.
I did make a volcano.
See?
I did.
Uh-huh.
Still a popular thing to do. You still do it the same way.
Well, the fourth and fifth graders will be doing a how-to, and then the sixth graders up will be doing exhibit boards. It's kind of a training on, you know, how to put together something that stands alone, plus then they have 2 minutes to
Which
talk
is a
about
thing
it.
That they have to do yes. a lot in the future in education.
That's exactly it.
I remember Jerry North made a neon sign.
Cool.
So his dad was Dana North and Sign Company. And if you went to his house, it was, you know, they made neon signs, so he made one for the classroom. So
I always tell him it's
fun. Explained how it worked, you know.
Yeah, some of my favorite over the years I have used is a pecan cake recipe that I've used from a 4-H'er and all kinds of things I learned, so I enjoy the demonstration time. We also do judging teams. We have Kim has a dairy judging team that's done very well. We have life skills where they actually learn how to count money out. You know, kids don't know that these days.
That's nobody uses
that's
money.
That's exactly it. And then we have consumer decision making where the kids have a problem like, let's say you need to go buy new luggage and here's your criteria. Here's how much you've got to spend. And then they give them 4 and they have to decide which one's the best.
And then you have to pay their cable bill and all. Good
yes.
morning. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Good morning, Ronnie. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Well, I'm trying to make it, but how's Debbie doing?
I'm right here. I'm doing cock-a-doodle-doo fine this morning.
Are you doing better?
I'm doing good. I'm doing real good. I finished my last chemo treatment yesterday.
Well, that's great.
Yeah, woohoo! And then I'm going to have a little bit of surgery, and then I'm back to 100%, I hope.
Well, that's great, and I'm glad to hear it.
Good.
But I missed both of you. I missed it last Saturday, and I thought, oh, Lord. It went completely off my habit.
No, our driveway is a real long paved driveway and it looked like an ice skating rink, and we decided we were going to break our necks getting to the car, and then once we got in the car we couldn't get to the road, so we just stayed at home. First time in 5.5 years that we've canceled.
Well,
and we couldn't tell folks like you why we weren't here, which bothered me.
Yeah. Well, I called somebody to ask you a question about the school. I had a lady to call me and ask me if it's going to have school on Saturday, and I said, I don't know nothing about that. I don't have any children in school. But I called a Moore, Ron Moore.
Yeah, wrong one. Yep.
Well, okay, and that's what I was wanting to know so I could tell her because she has three grandchildren.
No, I've worked in the school system 36 years, and we've never had a school on Saturday, as far as I know.
Well, that's what I told her. I said, that don't even make sense.
No, no.
I've enjoyed the program this morning.
Thank you, dear.
And I'm glad you're better and hope you continue on getting better.
Well, thank you. I'm planning on it.
Right after 12 o'clock, after the commercials, guess what I'm going to play?
Well, you better, because if I come down there and get you.
She likes to hear it's a swinging every week.
I'll tell you what, Ron.
Just a swinging.
I can find a CD of that. I'm buying it.
Well, I'll just have to find that for you.
Matt, I am.
All right.
That is the cleanest song, and he does such a great job.
It's a great song. It made him a lot of money.
Yes.
Made him famous.
Sure did.
I need one of those, don't I?
Yes.
You do.
I'm infamous. Isn't that the same?
It would help me, too.
Yeah. All right, dear. We'll see you.
I told y'all I had just gotten out of the hospital here 2 weeks ago, didn't I?
Yes, ma'am, you did.
Well, okay. I've had hip surgery on both right and left, too. But I got a problem, and I don't know what to do with it, and I don't think none of the doctors here that I've gone to, and I went back to my surgeon. It keeps swelling, and I have to get up and walk a little bit, and then I have to go back, sit down, and prop it up. So if anybody out there knows what they've ever had anything like that, I'd like to hear from them.
Well, I don't know if he'll cure it, but drink a glass of Jack Daniels, and you'll forget about it.
Ron, you're meaner than a snake.
Yes, ma'am, I am. You have a good day.
Thank you, darling. Bye-bye.
Same, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I love our comments.
One last thing.
All right.
It's camps.
Camp.
Do you ever go to camp? 4-H
no,
camp?
No, ma'am, I didn't.
I went first when I was a fourth grader. I've been about 21 times over the years.
You've been a fourth grader 21 times?
Well, I am in fourth grade class. For junior 4-H camp, we used to go to Crossville, mm-hmm. Camp York. Now we go to Greenville, Clyde Austin 4-H camp, junior high camp.
Woo.
I know. But you know what? It's really fun.
Well, they can kind of take care of themselves. You just have to watch them.
Yeah, you just have to have fun with them. We have Adventures in Appalachia that we do for fourth through sixth grades, and then fashion design camp.
Oh, that's good.
That sounds like fun. And electric camp. So if anybody's interested,
Ron needs to take electric camp.
That's it at the campus at UTK, and they do some wonderful things. One year they brought back lamps that they've made with the meters that's on the outside of your house.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Oh, fun!
Yeah,
huh?
So we've got a lot of things going on.
And Volunteer Electric helps us with sponsorship.
They do. And Cleveland Utilities also.
Both of them do a very good job
getting those kids there. Yeah, and we appreciate their help too.
Volunteer Electric's been very helpful to our master gardeners.
Wonderful experience for the kids to go stay on the campus mm-hmm. and learn a little bit.
That's so, where the majority of the money came from for the greenhouse was the Volunteer Energy Cooperative.
We've got some wonderful sponsors here mm-hmm. in Bradley County that help support our activities, and
That's right.
It's a good community.
Mm-hmm.
Robin, what do you got for us there?
Well, one thing I did wanted to add about the camps, last year we had an unusual occurrence. We have camps used to be fairly inexpensive, and now they have gotten pretty much expensive, and we have a lot of kids in Bradley County that their families just cannot afford to go send their kids to camp.
And I always found it was the kids that really wanted to go
absolutely
that didn't have the money.
So last year we had a little bit of money set aside, and we decided to offer some scholarships. We wound up with 32 applicants to go to camp, scholarships, and they were all good kids, and they all had needs. So we scrambled around and found people who had just were alumni 4-H that wanted to send a kid to camp. we got a couple of our girls were military girls, and so it was a couple of the military associations in Bradley County, the veterans and all, came up with money for those two girls to go to camp. Anyway, we wound up being able to send 52 kids to camp.
Wow.
Now we're starting camp promotion in March, and we're kind of curious. We're going to offer some scholarships again, but if we wind up with the response we had last year, we're going to have to come up with some more money again. So, you know, that may be something you want to think about. If it's if that was something that you enjoyed when you were a kid, maybe you would like to help sponsor a kid to go to camp.
And tax deductible, I'm sure.
Oh, yes, yes,
so,
yes, yes.
Know, yeah, absolutely. That, and it's just a good thing to do.
Oh, yeah, it's a wonderful thing to
right,
do.
So.
But, you know, the coolest thing about to me about Extension and 4-H and all is all these years that we've been in business, we're still doing the same thing. The basic premise is still the same. We still try to provide education to people in our community just to make their lives better, whether it's through the canning, through growing crops, through 4-H, through Family and Consumer Sciences. You know, we've changed and tweaked a little bit over the years, but basically what we do is solve problems. And if you ever worked the phones at the Extension office, you would not believe the problems that that
well,
came.
And, you know, like say, and for the listeners out there, you don't have to be a big-time farmer if your grass keeps dying.
Exactly.
Or you can't grow grass there, and Kim will come out and tell you, say, you're going to need some soil. You know, you can't grow it on rock, but if you have trees dying, if you have an insect infestation, wildlife problems,
absolutely,
which I went through last year. I live down towards the exit 20, and I live across APD 40 from where all that construction is going on, and all that habitat has been destroyed. They're living in my backyard now. And the groundhogs tried to live under my house. Mm-hmm. And then
and
the skunks tried to live under my house. And the foxes tried to live under my house. So I had a time at it. And I think I've got them all gone now. And all the holes stopped up till another groundhog come. They can dig a hole pretty fast. Oh, my goodness.
They're destructive.
And but, you know, like say, I caught the groundhogs coming out. And then I caught the skunk coming out. Skunks are harder to mm-hmm. take care of. A lot harder to get rid of, you know. Mm-hmm. I will admit, the groundhog, I hope I don't have that again. Now, you had something else you want to talk?
Well, we're kind of talking about how the more things change, the more they stay the same. You know, with the corn clubs and the tomato clubs and growing agriculture and helping people keep food safe. Food safety is a huge issue nowadays. And we still deal with that. We've still got publications and information. It's all research-based information on how to can things, how to cook things where your food will be safe. We also now, in the Family Consumer Science Department, do a lot of programs for the community dealing with health issues. Kay teaches a Dining with Diabetes class that is a wonderful series of classes that teach you just basically how to live with diabetes, how to eat, how to, you know, control that problem. She also teaches for classes for banks, for first-time home buyers. There's a class that she teaches for that to help you learn to budget and to be able to afford a home. She also teaches, and we still have our Family and Consumer Science clubs, or our Family and Consumer Education clubs. You know, that's what we used to call the
home demonstration
clubs. We mm-hmm. still have home demonstration mm-hmm. clubs. You know, we don't have as many as we used to have, but we've got young people that are still interested in maintaining homes, doing crafts, raising kids, raising grandkids. It's the same thing. Everything we do is basically the same as what we've always done. You know, it's just we tweak it in different ways.
So, you know, once again, our local agricultural office is 100 years old
mm-hmm.
now.
At least.
And,
in 2010, we were 100 years old.
100 years old. So there's
105 now.
105 years old. Mr. Ogle is a little behind you now. He's only 100. So, but a lot of things have changed. We talk about things changed now. Is that at one time, you know, they talked about the canning club starting up. It was important to make sure you can properly for safety. That was probably not how to can it as much as how to maintain that in a proper form. Because in the past, you had learned it from your mama and your daddy and your grandma. And if they had did it wrong all those years, it would just continue to be wrong. And so that safety of that, and then like I said, we didn't have Walmarts and grocery stores. Basically, fresh tomatoes come from what you grew or you could trade and eggs.
Well, you have to realize, too, they went through the war years, and so everybody had to, and the Depression, and you had to learn to take care of yourself.
Right.
But isn't it strange that we're getting back to that? We have lots of young families who are growing their own food and canning their own food because they're concerned about where their food's being grown. And it's safety, pesticides going on it. So we're doing the same thing. We're teaching these young families to grow and can as well.
Right. Yeah. Go ahead, caller. You're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Good morning, Ron.
Hey, Red.
I was just wondering, you said, somebody said something about not canning right. I think people used to can better than they do now.
Well, they practiced a lot more, and you know,
they knew what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you had more families that did it because that was part of preservation of food for your family throughout the year.
Right. So nobody can't tell me that they can better now than they did back then.
No, I think the only thing that you would think now is probably more safety-minded than back then, and more ways to make sure that you're safe. But I think the knowledge how to can, we're far behind where we used to be.
Oh, absolutely. I think one thing that we did learn, Ron, is that we didn't want to water bath green beans. We wanted to pressure cook them because of botulism, and that was a big thing that that may have happened, and we don't know how many cases or anything about it, but we don't water bath green beans anymore. We make sure we pressure can those.
Now, hang on just a minute.
Yeah.
I still water bath mine.
Oh, goodness.
And I've never lost one. I've never got sick on one.
Well, okay, you're very fortunate. Well,
what did you do with your corn?
With my corn?
Yeah.
Stuck it in the freezer.
No, that ain't what you did with your corn.
You didn't
I know
have
better.
A freezer then.
No, what did you do with your corn?
We carried it up in the woods.
It would come down liquefied.
What, well, it was good stuff, I reckon.
What did you do with the mash? Just throw it away? Or is there anything left out of that the cows would eat or the pigs would eat?
Nah, birds eat it. They just dumped it out when they got done with it.
And then the birds flew sideways.
Well, I've seen a few fly in the trees before.
Okay, Red.
Okay.
Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye.
She, her family was involved in that liquid activity there in the earlier day. What? Yep. I don't know. It was or is. I mean, I've got to get my right words involved here.
Well, you know, as technology advances too, we have to learn how to deal with things. You know, there for years, that's the only way we could can anything was out in the yard in a big kettle, you know. Then you had electricity come, so we had to learn how to use electric stoves and gas stoves and things. Then we had the microwaves come along, you know. So we have to learn and grow, you know.
You think people now just throw it in a Ziploc bag and freeze it more than anything?
It's possible, but, you know, to me, a frozen green bean is just not a green
bean. Oh, I agree. I'm just saying as though, but from the standpoint is, you can go to Walmart and buy a frozen bag of green beans.
Oh, you absolutely can.
And
you absolutely can.
You
can
buy about anything frozen now. It's unbelievable what you can get.
Absolutely. But like I said, again, we've got, you know, young parents raising a family, and they're concerned where those green beans came from.
Okay, I'm going to ask you a tough question right now. What's the difference between a jam and jelly?
Jam has the seeds in it, and jelly is all the seeds and things strained out.
So you actually use the fruit in the jam, and then the jelly's yeah. more just juice?
Yes.
And then what's the preserve?
Preserves also has is a thicker version of a jam. Mm-hmm. It's it can have seeds or less seeds, but it's more of a thick, pasty version.
I just wanted to know. They both taste, all three taste pretty good. It don't matter to me what you call them.
Well, everybody has their preference.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the thing about it. However Mom fixed it, that's the way you like it generally.
All right. Blackberries on the side of the road, they safe to eat?
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Just wash them good.
Yeah, right, now, just wash them good.
Here's the next right. real good technical question. How do you get the chiggers not to bite you?
Well, kerosene.
I used to use kerosene.
Kerosene, that's what Grandpa and Grandma used to always do with us when we'd go picking. Just take that. Well, it wasn't kerosene. It was coal oil.
Coal oil, yes, right.
Take that coal oil and rub your ring around your wrists and around your ankles, and that kept the chiggers from getting on you.
Yeah, it's important, too. Cause, you know.
They have all kinds of newfangled things to keep those things off. I know that...
you can buy blackberries frozen.
Yes.
Already picked and cleaned.
Already picked.
Or you can get them at the farmer's market yes, sometime, too. Yes, there'll be folks selling absolutely. Them there.
But, you know, they used to... Boy Scouts a lot of times will take old bars of lye soap and lather up in that lye soap and not wash it off.
Ooh.
And just let that dry, and that kept the chiggers off. I don't know. Probably kept a lot of things off, but
well, my
skin off.
Got me itching over here.
My grandmother would, she would get all the grandkids together, and we'd have to go pick blackberries. Of course, she'd make a good blackberry cobbler, you know, to pay for it and everything, but come back. And even no matter what I put on there, the chiggers got in places they shouldn't have got. I mean, just they get everywhere. And I ain't going any farther on that story.
Let's get back to the subject at hand, Ron.
Not that weren't on my hand.
Robin was talking about family and consumer science clubs or home demonstration clubs. I found something that was real interesting in some history that I think Judy Smith did. And Judy was the agent before Kay. Kay's doing family and consumer sciences now, and Judy Smith, and then... golly gee, I guess Miss Margaret Weeks was before
and,
her.
What was the
Miss Moore?
Miss Moore. Yeah. What was her name before
Barley.
She?
Huh?
Byerly. Maxine yes. Byerly. Now she was 4-H right. agent. She wasn't
yes,
home.
That's,
she wasn't.
That's true.
Right.
So they've not been very many family and consumer science agents. But I found something in a 1940 report. Now that wasn't too long ago, but. There was 654 mattresses made with 2,864 people participating.
Wow.
It's a lot of mat. They were made from 75 bales of cotton, 6,540 yards of ticking. And Ms. Margaret Weeks was the second home economist in Bradley County, and she was credited with bringing the home demonstration or home economics from organized unorganized groups to the organized groups in the community. So she was really a trailblazer and innovator and doing things that with people in the community.
Now, what did they do with those mattresses?
That's what I
wanted to
know. They gave them to people that needed. Well, in those days and times, I'm sure that they had more rodent problems and insect problems than we normally have now, and you'd have to change your mattress out quite often.
You did, but also mattresses were stuffed with straw,
right?
And that was a health issue, basically. So this was a government program that came in that said for a family of ever how many, you're allowed so many mattresses. So this allowed people to actually make their own. Families got together and communities got together, and it's kind of like a quilt bee, and they put these mattresses together and sewed them. They came with the ticking, the cotton, but the families made the mattresses with them, you know, as a group.
Mm-hmm.
So this was a hygiene type issue.
Now, this isn't the type of mattress you'd get at the store today. This is
absolutely
more just,
not. But no, this was luxury.
A lot
compared,
better, yeah, compared to a straw.
Compared to what they did have, you right. know, and beds, usually the bottom of the beds, you know, you're lucky to have wood slats. A lot of them were rope, strung with rope.
Mm-hmm.
And you had straw stuffed mattresses, and that was just not a healthy thing. And so that's what Extension does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we help make families better. We solve problems, make things better.
Go ahead.
You said mattresses wasn't the same. Quilts weren't the same then as they are now either. And that's one of the things that I think Robin's doing real good with the 4-H kids is we've kind of lost ways with sewing and how to sew and how to make things. And I think that's going to be a real good program for the kids that she's working with.
We're losing how to cook.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, there's all kind of things that just we don't do as much. You know, we eat out a whole lot more than probably our grandparents did. My parents, a lot more my parents and my grandparents did. Mm-hmm. Kim, if someone has a garden in their backyard, you know, and they want to make it better every year, what one thing could they do to that garden at the end of the season to make it better for next year?
Add organic matter. And it can be, like you said earlier, it can be leaves, it can be composted grass clippings, it could be composted kitchen waste, you know, just anything that. Now, if you're going to do the kitchen waste, don't put any meat in it because that tends to attract critters that right. You add. That's what you's doing. You's attracting them in. So.
Hey, there's no meat ever leaving my table.
I tell you what. But probably adding the organic matter because our soil types are not the best, and adding that organic matter helps them tremendously.
So just, if you can, just get all the leaves. If your neighbors have leaves, want to pour them in there, then do you turn them or just leave them on top?
Well, if you want to mulch them up, if you've got a chipper or some way to mulch them up, it works really good. But if you turn them under, that helps them to decompose quicker because that lets microbes get to them that'll break that organic matter down into usable stuff. Animal manures are really good. You know, horse manure, rabbit manure, you know, cow manure, poultry litter's good too. But now a lot of folks say I've got more weeds from poultry litter, and that's possible. They could be some weed seed or things that pass through the chickens, and so you know that's a problem sometimes.
The seeds fall out of my bird feeder and get down in my pool drain and grow interesting looking stuff.
That's the key thing is just put some kind of organic matter back in there.
Right.
Once again, the soil is not what the plant eats. It's what the nutrients it holds there. And their nutrients don't get there by themselves.
No, they do not.
Unless you're next to a tree and the leaves automatically fall into your garden spot, and then your garden spot is probably in the wrong spot then too because you don't get the right proper sunlight.
You don't get sunlight.
I learned a few things in master gardening.
And the trees are competing for moisture and other nutrients, so they're robbing the plants that you have underneath sometimes too.
Something else I learned in master gardening, about an hour in, they took a break and they had really good food. I remember that very well. Sam, you know, got to bring it back to reality here.
Yep.
Well, one of the things we're going to be doing, you know, we've got so many people in our community now that maybe moving in from different places or young families, and they have no idea what Extension does. And, of course, we've got Internet, and you can go on and find just about anything in the whole world you want to know on the Internet, but just because it's on the Internet does not mean it's so. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of people that have tried different things, Internet things. And
we've tried canned recipes that didn't turn out right.
Exactly. So Extension provides, you know, everything we put out is research-based information. But we are having a kind of a, what would you call it, a media push, and we're doing some publicizing Extension to kind of let the community know what we're doing nowadays in Extension, and we're going to be having a Explore Extension Day coming up March 7th and 8th, and we're going to be at the Bradley Square Mall and also over at the Tractor Supply. If it's a lovely day, we may be at the Greenway over there, what we call the Yellow Swing Park, you know, over there across from Cleveland High School. Mm-hmm. But we're just going to set up some displays and just kind of be talking to people about things we've got going, because I think a lot of people just don't know what we do, and you know, we're just a valuable resource that I think a lot of people are not tapping into. So we're going to be setting up, 4-H is going to be setting up, we're going to get some master gardeners, that Family Consumer Sciences will be setting up, and some of our nutrition programs. Of course, the kids will be 4-H. We're going to be doing some things on our animal clubs and different clubs that we have going. And by the way, Ron, we do have a brand new cooking club. because kids have expressed a great interest in learning to cook.
Good.
So, but this is going to be on March 7th and 8th.
Now, the Master Gardener program, it started now. If you're interested in becoming a Master Gardener, it's a 16-week course, once a week, about 3 hours a night,
mm-hmm.
somewhere around that range,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes spent eating. But really great courses in every type of anything you want to know, and some beyond there. Some of you are more interested in flowers, some more in vegetables, some in controlling wildlife, growing trees. There's something there for everybody, but at that, and then you can become a Master Gardener. You can take just the course to learn, or you can become a Master Gardener, which requires you to do some community service type hours and some continuing education. And we'd like to see more and more people in that group. I'm trying to get there. If I turn in my hours, it would be better. But if you're interested, that class has already started. You can't get in this class. Call the extension agency and say, I'm interested in the Master Gardener. They'll put you on a list and they'll get you a call. There is some cost to take the course. What is it?
This year it was $150, and that included all the courses that we do.
An unbelievable manual.
You get a big old thick manual that's got all of the resource material, and we also put together a notebook with some other things in it
that we think you need.
So, but it's a really, really good. You mentioned waiting list. This year we did not even advertise this year's class because we had – from different things that we had a waiting list, and we got all of our participants this year from those waiting lists. So we give them first shot. So, if you're interested in being a Master Gardener and learning about home horticulture, we cover a lot of different areas involved with home horticulture, anything from vegetable gardening and fruit production to insect and disease control.
Flowers.
Yeah, flowers,
shrubbery,
wildlife,
right.
all things involved.
It's like I say, it was a great class. Johnny Arnett come in and talked about, my mind just went blank, help me out here. What do you call it?
Native plants.
Native plants. I kept saying nature, and I didn't say native plants. And that's, I learned a lot about the native plants. And then the lady come in and talked about all the perennials.
Mm-hmm. And Ruth Baumgardner used to be owner of Mouse Creek Nursery in Riceville.
She got over my head real quick. She knew more about flowers than any human being I ever met in my life. She was very, very good, and I knew that I would never learn all that, but I knew where a resource was if I needed help, though.
Well, now, Ruth was the president of the National Perennial Plant Association, and I forget what year it was, but you're exactly right. She's a very, very knowledgeable lady.
Very nice. Like I say, so if you're interested, call the extension agency and put your name on the list, and you'll get a call next year. I kept trying to get in the class for 3 or 4 years, and my schedule never met until last year. And Johnny called me and says, you do it? And I said, it worked out perfect for me last year, and I got in, so I was really happy to do that. Also, if you're getting ready to start planting, soil tests are important. It's a little box. All you got to do is go down to extension agency, pick up the packages, and then it's complete instructions on how you mail it off. How long does it take to get the results back?
Normally about a week this time of year. Now, Robin mentioned this is a good time, and the reason being, if you wait until springtime, then you're going to be competing with all the folks growing corn and soybeans and others sending their samples in. So now would be a real good time to do it. The key is now to when you take that sample, and we've got directions on how to do that. If you don't know how to take a soil sample, we can teach you how to do that. But to let that soil dry out before you put it in that box and send it, because if you don't, when it gets to the soil lab, they'll just have to dry it, and they don't have any particular way of doing that other than opening the box and let it sit on
there.
The shelf.
Yeah.
And so, if you can put it in a pan or on a paper plate and set it in a windowsill and let it dry, that works a whole lot.
Don't nuke
it. It's quicker. Yeah.
Did we cover everything that you guys wanted to cover?
Well, the couple of things that I wanted, Patrick is not here today, but a couple of things that he's got going on, and it's kind of tied in with Master Gardeners a little bit, but it's a little bit different. every year we'll have folks that'll come in the office or call us and say, hey, I've got 5 or 6 or 8 acres out here and I'd like to grow something that I can get a return from that land. And so Patrick put together a thing called Profit and Production on Small Acreage. And basically what we're going to do is go through the different types of things you can do. Fruits and vegetables will be a big part of that. But he's also going to do small ruminant animals, like if you wanted to do some sheep and goats and have those, if you wanted to have a home poultry flock and sell some eggs, do some things like that. But it's a really, really good program. It filled up in about a week, I guess. We've got 35 signed up for that one too.
That's so great.
It's a really, really good thing. And that's kind of what TSU and Patrick does, is he works with those small farms, and that's kind of been their emphasis over the years. One thing that we'll have coming up will be in June will be the Tennessee Ag Enhancement Program. And a lot of our beef cattle farmers and sheep and goat, is they've got a lot of diversified agriculture. Aaron Swalford at Swalford Nursery, and I think Joe Washington at Black Fox Farms has participated in that too. But what that is, that's a state program, and they will cost share with you if you want to do certain things with your operation, like build a hay barn or get some handling equipment where you can handle your beef cattle easier and give them shots and that kind of thing. They have that open for 1 week. It's the first week of June, and you have to make application during that time. But we normally get those applications sometime in April. They'll get those out. So, but it's a really, really good program. I forget how many millions of dollars has been over the years that they've done. There'll also be some more spring and fall workshops that Patrick's doing, and I think he's putting together an estate planning workshop. And you know, you start thinking about things about, you know, when you get our age, Ron, we start thinking about those. What's going to happen to my estate when I'm not here any longer? And so this will help you prepare.
The large farms are very important.
Very, very, very important. Absolutely, and what you want to do with them and things. So. Will there be more information coming about that later?
Did we talk about the extension agency once being in the basement of the courthouse, the old courthouse?
No, we didn't.
We talked about that before the show.
Tell us
that little history bit there, because we only have about 5 more minutes.
Well, the building that we're in now is located at 95 Church Street. It's where the old jockey lot used to be. I've heard that for a lot of time since I've been back here, but it's right off of Inman, right behind
the old Chase.
Yep, used to be Chase Appliance. It's meager and meager furniture now. Mm-hmm. So we're right in behind there, and had Teddy Bear Restaurant, and I think the barbershop is still there.
Evans.
Now. Yeah,
Reed Evans
and Jute Miller. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure the lady now that's there, but
she's been there a little while.
She's been there a while, sure has. But that building was built in 1956, and the reason it was done is because the extension office was in the basement of the old courthouse. And the history says that they had to move them out because of flooding problems. It was just too wet in the basement, and something had happened, you know, get a big rain and it'd flood. So they built that building, and when they built it, there was all the government agencies that was involved with agriculture was there. You had the ASCS, which was Ag Stabilization and Conservation Service, which is now Farm Service Agency. You had Soil Conservation Service, which is now Natural Resource Conservation mm-hmm. Service. Farmers Home Administration. You had Farm Bureau actually had an office in there. And Production Credit Association, which is now Chattanooga Ag Credit. So, well, it's River Valley Ag Credit now, mm-hmm. I guess. They've changed their name again, too. So there were a lot of, and it was kind of like a one-stop shop for farming. And, of course, everybody's moved off and left us. And we had Tennessee Highway Patrol had an office there at one time. Mm-hmm. And they built a new testing center out at Paul Huff and moved out there. So, but we've expanded our staff, too. So we've got all our offices are full, and, you know, we're trying to, like Robin says, we're trying to help folks solve problems. If you have any problems, you can come and if it's something that we know anything about, if not, we'll try to find somebody that does know something about it.
And one of the good things, too, is that this is most of the services we provide are at no cost. You know, you can come by our office and get publications and things. It's not going to cost you a thing.
The soil example does, but that's for the testing.
Right. Exactly.
That's actually done at a lab at UT. So you know,
it's actually done at the lab in Nashville, and they do forage samples there too. If you've got, you're talking about hay for the horses. If you wanted to know what that hay had in it, you can send a hay sample in, and they'll tell you what the protein is and the fiber and all that kind, all the good stuff that we need to know when we're doing rations for animals.
So let's say real quick, a tree has some bad leaves on it, and you want, and they're looking weird. They just cut off a couple of them and bring them to you, and you'll tell them what it is instantly, right?
Bring us a twig of it. If we can't look at it and identify it, then we've got some folks we can get it to, or we will come out and visit with you and look at it. A lot of times we've done that. If you know, if the sample's not big enough, or you know, if we see something that we just don't quite know why it's doing that, we'll come out, and or somebody will say, well, is the whole tree this way? No, it's just about half that tree that way. So there's something that's causing that. So we'll come out with you and visit with you and look that thing over sometimes.
And we have the Master Gardeners organization, which we hope can help too. They could make a visit to your house. So this isn't just for farmers. I think that's the key thing, is if you just have 2 acres at home, or you have a lot in downtown Cleveland, you have a tree in there, and it's important that you find diseases, because these diseases could spread to other things, other crops, other other plants. Sometimes it's just that type of tree has a certain type of fungus or something that gets it, and it may not be anything that's going to affect except that tree. And you know, we heard about, you know, sometimes you got to cut some of it off, and sometimes you treat it.
And just folks finding different things is how we've identified a lot of things over the years. I know, we've had a lot of storms. We've had a lot of things blow in that, you know, it may be a weed that we've never seen before. I think that's how this emerald ash borer was found, that's attacking the ash trees. Mm-hmm. It came in and somebody found this insect and didn't know what it was, and actually it came in some packing material or in a crate from another country, and so that's going to be devastating to our ash trees.
Okay, folks, next week tune in at 9 o'clock, just to be sure. We may be having a Make It Grow show at 9 o'clock next week on March the 7th, just if we can get it arranged, because
we know we're going to have some coming up.
Yes,
we're going to have a series.
At least the 14th. Yeah, but tune in next week and early, shortly after 9 o'clock, so you won't have to hear the yelling that goes on between 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock on the politics show. But anyway, tune in, and because we might be on, and we'll have the manager of the Sequoia Museum from Von Ohr here next week.
From 10
and he'll
to
be
12.
Talking about vintage baseball, and he'll be talking about Fort Loudoun, and he can answer your questions about those things. Well, guys, this 2 hours has gone very quickly.
Got any final word? Join, get involved in 4-H, right?
Absolutely.
Parents,
yes.
Ask your kids about it.
Right.
Yes, we send a newsletter home, so ask your child where that newsletter is.
Yes, it's in the bottom of something.
That's exactly.
Wadded up in a coat pocket or something, but ask about 4-H and encourage your kids to get more involved.
And come join us on March 7th and 8th. You'll see a lot of those exhibits and things that the kids are doing too.
And tell us where all that is again.
We're going to be at Bradley Square Mall, Tractor Supply, and weather permitting over at the walkway.
On Cleveland Greenway.
Right.
Sign up for the Master Gardener class coming up next year. You'll be hearing more about the Junior Gardening Program, which is with the court system here, the juvenile court system, and unbelievable success with that too. There's very little failure in that classes of kids returning into trouble. Not 100%, but you know, if it's 1%, it's better than nothing.
Absolutely.
But it's up in like the 90%, so that's pretty unbelievable. And
give them some skills.
And we have some of these teenagers want to become master gardeners now.
Oh, absolutely. And we've had some that's graduated from that program come back and help the next class. And I think that's a great
wonderful
success story.
That's a great success story.
Right. Well, folks, that's been it. We'll be here again next week. And Thank you, and be listening to that song, Swangin's coming on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, swinging out there, drinking a little Jack Daniels with her. That's what she's going to be doing on the back porch. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
You are listening to WOOP-LP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music. Check into, check in a cat.